Hello there, my fellow fans of Genghis Khan-inspired Primarchs, and welcome to part 3 of my Jagatai Khan coverage. Before I go further, I feel I should issue a big spoilers warning regarding this episode and the next episode as well. And by spoilers, I'm talking about the Horus Heresy novels Scars and Path of Heaven. Since I did ask you guys, and the answer was, overwhelmingly, go for more detail, that's exactly what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna cover, in more detail, the stuff which happened to the Khan and the White Scars during the Horus Heresy, or at least the stuff which happened in those two novels. I am your host, the Grimdark Narrator, and without further ado, let us see what the Khan did next, shall we? Jagatai was next contacted by the Space Wolves Primarch Leman Russ, who had just returned from the burning of Prospero. The 6th Legion's fleet had mustered at the Adraxis Nebula to lick its wounds after the recent campaign, when it was beset by the forces of the Alpha Legion. Horus had deployed the 20th Legion to launch a massive assault on Russ's battered and outnumbered Space Wolves. The Alpha Legion and its twin Primarchs, Alpharius and Omegon, had long harbored deep grudges against the Space Wolves, and Russ in particular, for his criticism of their reliance upon trickery, manipulation, and subterfuge. Although the Khan sympathized with the Space Wolves' predicament, he refused to get involved until he was able to sort out the conflicting and contradictory messages he was receiving. Until he knew, beyond a shadow of a doubt, who was ally and who was enemy, he refused to choose a side. As the White Scars fleet made preparations to depart the Chondax system, they also encountered a massive Alpha Legion fleet. They did not respond to communication requests and had hung back on the edge of the system, quietly accumulating more warships across a wide sweep of local space. All White Scars vessels were ordered not to escalate the situation, and not to fire unless fired upon. Every move that the White Scars ships made was reflected by the Alpha Legion warships, in what became a bizarre game of mirrors. Though the Alpha Legion had not presented a threat, these were also not the actions of a friend. Things became even more complicated when they received more official messages directly from Terra and Rogel Dorn himself. The White Scars were again commanded to make the swiftest possible passage to the Throne World, where additional instructions and explanations would be given. The meaning was clear, its origin unambiguous. The 5th Legion had been ordered to ignore all other claims to their fealty, in particular those from War Master Horus. But the Khan was not moved by these demands. He felt the old stirrings of resentment again, the chill anger of an unregarded son. A price had to be paid for his inclination to freedom, for skirting along the edges of communication. The White Scars were always the last to know. He saw the larger strategic picture. The Alpha Legion did not wish to fight the White Scars, nor did they wish to join them. They wanted to cause doubt, keeping the White Scars in the Chondax system to tie them up in questions, because they knew the veil was slowly lifting and messages were only now getting through the ether of the warp. But the White Scars were nobody's pawns. They were the Ordu of Jagatai, and they took orders from no one but him. They were on their own, just as they had always been, and if there was a truth to be found in all this, then they would find it themselves. For what followed, I think it's important to mention that the 5th Legion's tech marines had spent decades boosting reactor power feeds and finding ways to increase maneuverability in all the White Scars vessels. This was done with a single goal in mind: to make the White Scars faster than anyone, even in the void. The endless pursuit of velocity came with its cost, however. Gunnery captains had been heard to complain of reduced lance range, and it was well known that the White Scars warship would not carry as many troops or dropships as the equivalent vessel of a standard fleet. Finally, the Khan ordered the fleet to move. As the White Scar's vessels began to move, the Alpha Legion reacted. They maintained the integrity of their cordon, warding the routes to the nearest suitable jump point and keeping the White Scars corralled within the vicinity of Chondax. All along the front, White Scars ships probed the line, and Alpha Legion ships resisted them. It was a classic containment pattern, designed to hem the 5th Legion formation in and prevent isolated warships from running the cordon. The White Scars' vanguard began to drift spinwards, pulling clear of their jump point trajectory and dragging the center of the engagement back towards Chondax's gravity well. It looked almost careless, as if aimless commanders had launched a half-hearted breakout without the commitment to see it through. Soon, the drift became even more pronounced as the intensity of the last fire picked up. For all that, the engagements were muted, probing and restrained. No torpedoes were launched and no gunships were unleashed. When the chrono reached zero, the White Scar's vessels moved, every one of them all at the same time into full attack speed. Everything quickly changed as the 5th Legion's fleet formation morphed in an instant, suddenly switching from an aimless drift pattern into an arrowhead shock assault of astonishing precision. The White Scar's vessels were now in trajectories and in perfect concert, suddenly leaping from semi-committed holding patterns into a single attack vector. The Alpha Legion most likely had never witnessed such ship mastery. Escorts shot out, pulling together in a single mass and punching a hole through the enemy cordon. Their sudden burst of speed and concentrated land strikes wrong-footed the Alpha Legion vessels in their path, and three bronze-prowed destroyers were overwhelmed almost immediately, lost amid a whirlwind of plasma and exploding torpedo trails. The encircling Alpha Legion cordon was now compromised and fractured, its constituents struggling to respond to the lone column of ships that burned its way through their heart. Their capital ships were even slower, unable to take advantage of modified engines or the White Scar's supernaturally skilled ship crews. The Swordstorm, Jagatai's flagship, pulled up to the forefront of the Chisel formation, propelled by its monstrous raging plasma engines and surrounded by a swarm of racing escorts. Bulky vessels of the Alpha Legion's second rank tried to bar their way, sliding into a hurried defensive formation with what now looked like ponderous clumsiness. The Alpha Legion struggled to regroup in its wake, pulling warships from the far-flung cordon formation like an octopus clutching its many limbs back to itself. They had not lost a lot of ships, but the sudden attack run had blown their formation wide open and destroyed any cohesion. The White Scar's run didn't slow. If anything, free of the need to maintain a barrage of last fire, it accelerated. As the orb of Chondax fell rapidly away, it was mediated by the glowing corpses of a dozen burned-out Alpha Legion warships. The White Scars understood that fate was against them. Somehow, the warp storms around Chondax had been orchestrated by some mysterious outside force. Yet, only one soul could see the warp as it truly was, and that was Magnus the Red, the only one of his brothers that Jagatai had ever really trusted. If Magnus was yet alive, then everything could be salvaged. If he was dead, then the Imperium was finished. The White Scars set course for Prospero. Soon, the Thousand Suns' homeworld swam into extreme sensor range. Blurry pict feeds flickered into life, clarifying rapidly as servitors adjusted the logic engines. The planet was entirely dark. Prospero had once been a jewel of a world, pristine when seen from space, untouched by the hyper-industrial sprawl of Terra. Now it was the mottled color of burned charcoal. As the White Scars moved into orbit, the Khagan instructed them to blockade, then prepare for planetfall. If his ships detected anything with a Fenrisian marker, they were ordered to kill it. By the time the Swordstorm reached geostationary orbit around the capital city of Tiska, there was no longer room for any doubt. Atmospheric readings came in, adding to the visual evidence. there was substantial tectonic activity. Atmospheric pollution levels were far in excess of mortal tolerance. These markers were indicators of a heavy bombardment consistent with mass drivers from orbit, followed by secondary trauma. Toxins across a wide spectrum were present in lethal quantity, and extensive volcanism scarred the equatorial zone. Something in the upper atmosphere, an etheric field, was preventing the white scars from sending down landers or drop pods. The world was rapidly dying, and the phenomenon was still growing, perhaps as a result of what happened here. Undeterred, the Khan opted to teleport to the surface. But it was made clear that the topographic interference might make it impossible for the flagship to extract the Primarch, or even make Vox contact. Jagatai acknowledged this, and along with 12 of his elite Keshik bodyguard, went down to the unstable surface of Prospero. As the Primarch and his warriors explored the ruined capital city, they observed the scene of devastation stretching away under the darkened sky. The whole city reeked of burning metal. The Khan's armor senses told him that the surfaces around him were still warm from the afterglow of whatever apocalypse had overtaken Prospero. Everything was simply gone. All the libraries, the repositories, the arcana. If the Space Wolves really did this, then perhaps their power did match their boast. The Khan instructed his warriors to search for the caves that he knew were under the city. They would begin their search for the Crimson King there. On Prospero, it was difficult to witness what had become of Magnus's iridescent city of glass and crystal. As the Khan investigated further, he heard an unmistakable buzzing noise, like the drone of 100 massed insect wings. Even though there were no life signs detected, the Khan could not shake the feeling that he heard a distinctive buzzing sound. The Khan ordered his warriors to disable their autosenses and to use their own eyes, blink dismissing the lattice of targeting reticules and environmental compensators hovering in their field of vision. Only then did the white scars see them, shimmering in spectral blue-white, arthropodic, winged, and massive. There were dozens of them, sliding up out of the ground like unquiet shades rising from the grave. They were ruined things, twisted and hunched, though still twice the size of the Terminators around them. The Khan recognized the vile creatures immediately. Psyche Nguyen, vile warp entities drawn to the mental emanations of unprotected psychas. These creatures would use the minds they attack for the obscene purpose of gestating their progeny. They had been a blight on the otherwise benign world of Prospero for centuries, consuming the minds of mortals. The Thousand Suns had hunted them, driving them into the wilds and far from their glittering spires. But now, like everything else, they had been reduced to ghosts. Only, unlike all the other destroyed fauna, they had retained some vestige of their old will. The White Scars quickly found that their weapons had no effect on the spectral insects. Unable to fight such fell creatures, the Khagan ordered his warriors to fall back. As Jagatai fought them himself, the ground beneath his feet gave way, the flagstones damaged by the Space Wolves' relentless orbital bombardment. Falling for a long distance, the Primarch came to a final halt. Buried up to his chest in the fallen debris, the Khan attempted to contact his Keshig on the surface, but he received nothing but static. Pulling himself free from the pile of rubble, Jagatai found himself in a strange underground world of sinkholes and chasms that might open up into something bigger. He had come looking for caves, and the caves had found him. Back on the surface, Keshig Master Quin Zha, while retreating from the Psyche Nguyen, found an actual surviving member of the Thousand Suns. This guy's name was Arvida, and he will become both a friend of the White Scars and an important character further on. Jagatai Khan made his way through the newly discovered tunnels. He had been able only to go down, despite many attempts to find a route back up. The Psyche Nguyen had not followed him down, but the absence of any movement beside his own was chilling. As he stared grimly at the macabre surroundings around him, he suddenly felt a restless, gentle movement in the dust. A ghostly outline of a figure flickered, burning coldly. He stood a little taller than the Khan, just as he had done in life. His face was the same, though the expression was infinitely weary and a little distracted. Holding his ground, the Khan stood speechless, still gripping his blade. But his defensive posture was not necessary. When the figure spoke, the voice dispelled any trace of doubt. It was an apparition of his missing brother, Magnus the Red. At first, the Khan did not believe the evidence of his eyes for a long time. The Shade then explained that it was merely a remnant of Magnus, a dream of something destroyed. He told the Khan of how he had tried to warn the Emperor about the betrayal of Horus. That was his crime, and the destruction of the Legion and his homeworld was his punishment. It was only pride, that was all. Pride that had swallowed Horus as well as him. The ruinous powers waited, and they watched, and they realized what the Primarchs had not. That only the Primarchs could destroy the Primarchs. Only they could bring down the Eternal Imperium, because everything else had been annihilated. That's what Lorgar called the Chaos Gods, the Primordial Annihilator. At this point, most of the Primarchs, without even realizing it, had already cast in their lots in this great drama about to unfold, and only a couple remained. They were now lined up, one by one, to tear at each other's throats. The Khan was one of the last. Because of their wild and free nature, not even the Chaos Gods knew which way the White Scars would go. None of them did, and that was why the White Scars had the eyes of the galaxy upon them at last. Chagatai Khan had never taken sides. He would take on everyone if he had to. But the Shade of Magnus explained there were only two paths to choose from. He could hunker down in what remained of their father's Imperium and try to keep Horus from battering down the door, or he could choose to remember how Horus had once been, and stand at his side as he brought terror to the complacent. The first would be the more loyal course, but the other had its own merits too. When Jagatai pressed Magnus for where his allegiances lay, the Shade explained his choices were constrained. He now knew more than anyone what awaited them on the other side. Magnus had unwittingly burned all his bridges with the Emperor. After all these great reveals, the Khan did not quite believe that the apparition that now stood before him truly was his brother. The Khagan had come to Prospero to find a friend. Whatever else happened, he thought he could come to Magnus for counsel. Despite all this, Magnus still wanted to know whose side Jagatai would take. The Khagan was ambiguous about this choice, for he believed that Horus was corrupted, but also that the Emperor was a tyrant. The Khan finally informed him that he would choose neither, but Magnus explained it didn't work like this. Sooner or later, the Khan would have to choose a side, and then the next time they would meet, they would either be allies or enemies. Jagatai still had a choice, and Magnus implored his brother to make the right one. The Magnus apparition explained that it was glad that the Khan had come to see him, because they had always seen eye to eye. Though he thought Jagatai was a bit brittle, at least he always spoke the truth. When they finally concluded their conversation, the Khan informed Magnus that he had got what he came for. He told Magnus that he had always been his friend. Magnus understood and looked at the Khan for a moment. Jagatai knew then what he had to do. With one final parting word, Jagatai swung his great Guan Dao and struck Magnus's outline, and the ghost shell shattered, spilling into a thousand pieces like broken glass. The Khan remained still bowing his head. At least, among all the numbness, the truth was now known. The choice could be made, for the traitor had been unmasked. Duty could be done now, and the call to war could be given. But for all that, he still couldn't stir for a long time, as the dream he had believed in had finally died. And this, my friends, has been what I wanted to tell you about the Khan's story for today. In the next episode, I will be covering his duel with Mortarion, though not that richly because I already talked about it, the little civil war within the White Scars Legion, and probably their escape to Terra at the Dark Glass installation. If you have any thoughts or questions about this topic, always feel free to write them down in the comments below. Was this video enjoyable or informative? In that case, please click on the like button and subscribe for future videos. I thank you very much for watching, and I will see you next time. The Emperor protects.